I forgot my bell. It's a hot mic. I forgot my ship's bell to call the meeting to order, but... Oh, we have the... 7 o'clock.
All right.
7 bells. Well, welcome tonight to the November meeting of the Historical Preservation Society of the Upper Keys. And before we start the meeting, I want to say thank you to Bruce, the pastor of Coral Isles Church, and he'd like to speak to you for just a second.
No sermons.
No sermons.
Just, I've been a poor host. I have not said thank you all for coming and being part of this. This is a tremendous contribution to the community to have this, what the Historical Society does. So thank you all for being here. If there's anything we can do to help make it better, let us know. And Coral Isles Church welcomes you. Thanks for being here tonight.
Great, thank you. The presentation tonight is going to be Historic Tavernier, because there are more historic homes and buildings in Tavernier than any other place in Monroe County except Key West. And no better person to tell us about that than Loralea Carrera. So, without any further ado, come on up and tell us about Tavernier.
We mentioned Charles Lewis Pelletier, who's in the back. He's a lifelong member of Tavernier. He just celebrated his 94th birthday, and he was very helpful when we put this slideshow together. Okay, I'm going to start with Tavernier. The beginning of Tavernier really started when the railroad went through. There was a settlement of planters out in the area of Harry Harris Park. But with the coming of the railroad, people wanted to be near the railroad. So that was around 1908, basically started Tavernier. And where did the name Tavernier come from? We really don't know the exact reason, but Tavernier Key, you know, the island on the ocean side, it's offshore. That was known on all Spanish charts, it was listed as Tavona Key or Tavona Key, which meant horsefly. Now, how if Tavernier would evolve from that, we're not really sure. So here's one of the earliest pictures. This is the first school in Tavernier. It was probably on somewhere on the ocean side of the Alderley property, 1914. And this is the first post office opened in 1911, and Merlin Alderley was the postmaster, and then later years of Harold Alderley, and then later on was Edward Alderley. So there was an Alderley postmaster up until, I think, the 70s. But how long was Edward, Charlie, how long was Edward the postmaster? I don't even remember. Anyway, up to about the 70s, it was always an Alberry, a postmaster. This is 1927. Okay, the first overseas highway opened in 1928. So I don't know whether this is still a dirt road or it was paved yet. So when you're out there driving on Tavernier, when you're on the northbound lane, that was the first overseas highway, we call it the old road, and the southbound lane, it was the railroad track. This picture was taken by the, do y'all know where Old Settlers Park is?
Yes.
Well, this is probably, picture was taken standing about where Old Settlers Park is. And the building on the left would have been, you know, what was used to be Cafe Mocha, which is now called Crust. And there used to be buildings in the center. There was that shows the ice house, and there was many other buildings in the center. All that was removed in the 60s when Tavernier was four lane. Now, the section of Tavernier was the first section to be four lane on Key Laurel, thanks to our county commissioner at the time, Harry Harris. And his home was in Tavernier, so Tavernier got four lane first. You know, this is an early picture. By the way, people dressed, it obviously was a Sunday. And everybody went out to be trained. And I bet you to say this about everybody in that picture was an Alberry. And I just put this picture here just to show the railroads and boxcars. And then all taken basically in the same area. As I said, all this building was in between the road and the railroad. And that building there by the railroad, that was the ice house, and that was a meeting house right next to it. And these buildings were also in the center. That was the section foreman's house on the right. That was one of the flagpole railroad houses. And when the railroad was done away with, the U.S. one was created, this house was moved down to Indian Key Hill. It was a place on the north end of the Indian Key Bridge. Back then there was a drawbridge, so they needed a home for the bridge tender. So it was placed on Indian Key Hill, and it was there up until, I guess it was in the early 80s when they built the new Indian Key Bridge, and then that house was torn down. And of course, in all those years, our bridge tender was Mary Eichert. That's another picture. And this picture is the only one I know of that shows that large building on the right. That was the Tavernier Depot. That's really the only photo that we have of the actual depot. And you can see the railroad in the background. That's looking northward. And this was taken in the late 20s. This is one of the early 30s. The hotel, Tavernier Hotel, wasn't built yet, so it was taken, the picture's taken before that. And the building there in the center, it says Keith's Theater, that's the building that was Cafe Mocha. Over the years, there was many different businesses in there up until today. And right next to it was a gas station. Now, this is a building still in Tavernier. This is the post office in 1947 to 1961. The building's still there. There's a business in there now called Bloom. Anyway, it's my granddaughter-in-law, Elena, has a spa. And this is Harold Mulberry. He was a postmaster in the years that this was the post office. He lived upstairs, and of course, and downstairs was the post office. And that shows the back of the post office. And the reason I use that photo, it shows the water storage tanks. If you know, we did not have running water on Keys until 1942, but they didn't put in the pipeline because they needed water in Key West. It was World War II was going on and they needed water for the naval station in Key West. So everybody depended on these water tanks up until 1942. And not long after that, they actually had electricity also. Before the co-op was created, basically they needed power for the pumping stations to get the water to Key West. Okay, this is the first generator that S. McKinsey put in. And it was located in the parking lot right behind the building that was recently Cafe Mocha. And it was a small generator. It supplied power 2-3 hours in the morning and then 2-3 hours in the evening, or, you know, around dinner time. And there was no, it's all messy. This is a picture of the same area. The building on the left is the building that was Cafe Mocha, and the building in the middle, that was the gas station, which I think it's Dr. Heidi on it now. And the people in the picture is Ralph Gillespie. He was one that drove the gas delivery truck. And Dick Bland, and that's Louis Pelletier on the right, which is Charlie Pelletier is in the audience, that's his dad. And he ran the gas station.
Yeah.
And this is the first delivery truck that McKinsey had for Standard Oil. He not only delivered gas, he also delivered ice and milk. And this is one of the earlier homes that came here. This is the home of Rodney Alberry. It's still there, but it's been highly modified and down to. It's hardly recognizable anymore, but it's still there in the ocean at the end on Albury Lane. This is a painting by Geraldine Green. She's a very well-known artist here in the 80s and 90s. I don't know if any of you remember her, but she painted a lot of local historical places. And this house is located in what is now Old Settlers Park. That was a property of Roger. Roger and Sarah Albury. That was their home. It was cut later before it was created as a park. It was sold to the Eatons. It was cut in half. It was cut in half and totally carried all the way down to Loralea County, where it's located now. It's on Columbus Drive. I recently saw some pictures on Facebook, and it was completely renovated since Hurricane Irma, but it's now a vacation rental. But it's right on, if you go to Loralea County, it's right, as you turn in and go to Columbus Drive, that's where it's located now. And this was an early grocery store of Robert Albright. It was right on the corner. Well, there's still the Sunrise Market is there, right on the corner of Atlantic Circle. There's always been a grocery store on that corner. So there was, early on, this is Roger Albury's store. Then later on, it becomes Doug's Grocery. And then they tore this old woodman down, and there's a new one in the back, and became Claire and Doug's Grocery. Then it was Sunshine Market, now it's Sunrise. And I'm not sure if it's open up. Some people said it's closed, and they said it's open again. Does anybody know if it's open?
It's open.
Is it open?
Yeah.
But it's open now, okay. Now, here again, this is a building that was recently cafe open. After it was a theater, it became the first tavern store. That was the second business that was in there. Okay, this picture was taken probably the late 20s, early 30s. When the hotel was built, it was built as a theater originally. See, there's no windows in the hotel, so it was still a theater in that picture. So I'm going to say it was either late 20s or early 30s that that picture was taken. Well, anyway, it was a theater for 2 years. It wasn't profitable, so it was converted into a hotel. This is another, also on the ocean side, north of there, was all the homes along there were all very homes. This is now the Visiting Nurse Association that's there now. And this is J.B. Albury home. And that's in the back, and there it shows the water tank. Everybody had a half water tank. And this was home was on Atlantic Circle. So home of Captain and Frances Tracy. You may have all heard of Frances Tracy. She was known as the Angel of the Keys. They retired and moved to Tavernier in 1938, I think. Well, they were coming here and built a house in the 20s, but they retired and moved here in 1938. And of course, there were no doctors. If he was sick, he had to go to Homestead or Key West. So she was a retired nurse. She worked with Dr. Jackson and was instrumental in helping Dr. Jackson start Jackson Memorial Hospital. So anyway, she started treating people. She would treat more, sometimes 10, 50 people a day, or whatever ailed them, even removing fish hooks. So anyway, people got together and a person named her the Angel of the Keys. And by the way, who knows, the garden club north of Tavernier is called Frances Tracy Garden Center. And when the land was donated by Dr. Bond, owned all the land in there. And when he donated the property, 1 acre, to the garden club, the only requisite was to name it after Frances Tracy. So that's how the garden club came to be known as the Frances Tracy Garden Club. And sadly, that house burned down in the 70s. It's a neat house, it's too bad. Not still there. This is on the corner of Coconut Grove. It was originally known as the Geiger House. It was used as a packing house downstairs and had living quarters upstairs. Hmm. This is kept right there, Ronnie's. I guess you could call it a charter boat. He was one of the first fishermen that took people out fishing in the Tavernier. And it was Edgar Marr, and it was named after Edward, his son, Rodney, and Marr, his daughter Margaret, or Margie. And he did take President Franklin Roosevelt fishing when he came down here and did fishing. It was one of his noted fishing customers. And here's another person that's, I guess you call it, Tavernier pioneer, did a lot of building Tavernier House, Cliff Carpenter. And that's there in front of the William of Building Hotel. That's him out front, and his wife, Shorty. Sure, there's some people here who remember Shorty.
Yes.
And this is one of the buildings that was in the median between the road and the railroad. It was used for many things, like a meeting house and different things. Now this picture was taken looking south. This is taken after the 35 hurricanes. You see, most of the buildings survived the hurricane, not like Alamorado where everything was totally wiped out. Most of the houses survived. They just floated off the foundations and wound up somewhere else, and everybody just moved their houses back to where they belong. The house on the right belonged to Bob Holmes. It's out of the picture, but on to the right, he had a gas station in the center. It was a pure oil station. And this was the first Harris place. It belonged to Harry Harris. This is the first, and this is right next to the hotel. You can see the hotel on the left. This is the first Harris place. Now this is a photo taken inside. And by the way, anyway, Harry Harris was the county commissioner for 28 years continuously. He served over 35 years as our county commissioner, but continuously for 28 years. Actually, nobody opposed him. Okay, this is when the hotel was first completed. This is when it was used as a theater. You notice there's two entrances. The one on the left was the entrance, and the door on the right is to leave. And you notice that bench there next to the hotel. Every afternoon, all the local men would gather there, and it became known as the liar's bench. Does anybody need an explanation about that? And you can see the gas station on the left. And then after the 35 hurricanes, the WPA built two schools. They built this one, which is on Georgia Street, which is close to the fire department, and the one in Alamorado, which is now the Alamorado Library. And that's a view inside the school. The teacher was Violet Alberry, which was the mother of Shirley Bay Alberry. I'm sure a lot of people here remember Shirley Bay. This is her mother was this teacher. More than that, this is the building next to the hotel. For many years, it was a gas station, and later on, it was one of the rentals for the hotel. And like I mentioned earlier, now there's a big sign that says Dr. Heidi on it. And you know, it's between the hotel and the building that was Cafe Mocha. And this is the same building, and it was still the tavern store. This is H.S. McKenzie. He was responsible for most of the building you see in the Tavernier. It's all done by H.S. McKenzie. In the beginning, he had a partner, O.M. Woods, but O.M. Woods passed away in 1934, so we don't even have a picture of him, and I don't know a lot of history. He was just an early partner of H.S. McKenzie in doing the original buildings in Tavernier. And that was his son Johnny next to him. And this, in the 1940s, they built a new tavern store across the street. This building's still there. It's right in the location, well, right next to it is the Tavernier Hardware. I think everybody should know where Tavernier Hardware was. And this building is still there. There's several businesses in there. But I think there's a place that sells tile and some other things. But that was the place that had they had a lunchroom there. The Greyhound bus stopped there. I think that back in those days, it was a Greyhound bus about every hour. And that was their stop. And that was the gas station in the median that was cutting out. The Pullman and Bob Combs, it was a pure oil station. And this is a little bit further, so this is on the bayside of US 1. It was known as the island, and later years it became known as the Bahama Inn. There might be somebody here who remembers the Bahama Inn. Of course, that was all torn down, and this is a bunch of stores in there. One of you might remember Craig's restaurant. So it's been gone, but it was in that where all those stores are in that area. And what was so neat that you can't see it for the bougainvillea, but it was made out of coral rock. And this is Key Haven. Coconut Palm Inn's there now. This was built by Herb Cowley. He was another pioneer. Tavernier did a lot of building in Tavernier. And if you all know two streets in Tavernier, Dickey Way and Joe Jean Way, are all familiar? Those were Herb Alley's children's names. And this is the home of Marvin Sterling. The Sterling Street Road is named after him, and that's his home. It's no longer, I don't think it's there anymore. And this shows the whole, this is taken later years, and it shows the hotel. And on Sunrise, there used to be a resort on the ocean. This is the sign named, it was at the corner of Sunrise on the ocean side. And it was owned by Adrian Rollini, who was a famous jazz musician. And that's a picture of the resort that was on the ocean. It was just totally destroyed in Hurricane Donna. Now we're back to, this is Captain Tracy's house. We're back here again. During 1941-42, he built a yawl in his yard. It was called the Ulysses. And notice the men inside the boat. Notice the boy in the center of the boat with the sailor hat on. That's Charles Lewis Fellows here, who's in our... I know when I first showed him that picture, because he helped me out. Identifying a lot of the pictures, he was looking at me and he says, "Oh, that's me!" And the house on the right belonged to a family called Dimmick. Now this is a road right across, heading toward the ocean, across from where the hospital is, the Coconut Road. This was taken in 1947. It was still a dirt road, and as you see, there was nothing on it. And then later on, a corner Atlantic Circle, and then it was Doug's grocery, Doug's Killingsworth. This is just another picture of Violet Oliveri in her class, and this picture is taken outside in front of the school. And this is, the school was used up until 1951, when Carl Schwartz opened. This is a postcard taken around 1956. And on the left there, you could see the original co-op building. They had two generators. There was no Turkey Point, and the power did not come down the mainland. There was two little generators supplying all electricity from Key Largo to Long Key. No, it's looking north. And those are the generators that supplied all our... Well, there weren't that many people here then, of course, but that supplied all our power. This was taken in front of the tavern store. And the reason I posted it, I thought we'd like to see what highway patrol cars looked like back in those days. Originally, there was one highway patrolman, Slim Walker, who patrolled Key West to the county line. Wow. This is the Mayview Bar and Restaurant. The Bill and Tavernier hasn't always been the Elks Club. It was originally Donnie Donaldson's Bayview Bar.
That's the Elks Club?
Yes, yeah, not the Elks Club. Like I said,
oh, yeah.
A lot of people, it's been the Elks Club so long, I don't think anybody realized it wasn't always the Elks Club. This is another postcard view. This is looking toward the ocean. You can see Tavernier Key on the right hand, upper right hand corner of the pickup postcard. As you can see, there wasn't a whole lot in Tavernier when that was taken. 1956. This is another early gas station, Tavernier. It was a Sinclair station. Later years, it became a bus station. And the property is now part of the where Froggy's Gym is located. And also, the Lindsay Lumber was on the corner next to that gas station, and that's also part of Froggy's Gym property. That's Looking House. That picture was probably taken, probably stand in one of the warehouses. It was in the median. Somebody probably stood on there to take that photo. Because you can see the Tavernier hadn't been four lane yet. That was still the old road on the left. And I don't know if I mentioned earlier, the first Overseas Highway opened in 1928, but it only went to Lower Matacumbe. Then you have to take a ferry to No Name Key. Then you could get on the ferry and then drive the rest of the way to Key West. But you weren't able to drive all the way to Key West until the Overseas Highway that we know now opened in 1938. And then up until 1954, they had toll booths you had to pay. The toll booth going south was at the end of Lower Matacumbe, and then coming north, there was a toll booth at the north end of Big Black Key. This is another early business in Tavernier, and this was just south of the Elks Club, and it was the Bayview Cabins. And this is the second Harris Bar. And the location is where the electric pull-up building is now, on the Bayside. And then my years of Dutch grocery, the old wooden building was torn down, they built a new one in the back. And this is a new Clara Dubs grocery. And then it became, in later years, it became the Sunshine Market, and now it's the Sunrise Market and Cuban Restaurant. And that's Clara Dubs Gildensworth. And the reason I put this picture there showing Tavis for the Greyhound bus I brought. Back in those days, I think it was a Greyhound bus every hour. Or the tavern store was their Tavernier stop. And you notice that the truck in the center of the picture there was some lumber on it. That was McKinsey's delivery truck. And I was talking to Sylvia Murphy, who used to be our county commissioner, and she said that was known as the Ooga Ooga machine. Now this is a good aerial view of Tavernier, and this was taken in the mid-1950s. You see that right in the very center of that straight street, that's Tavernier Drive. You know, that's behind the hotel. And a lot of the older homes I show later on in the slideshow are on that street. And by the way, that was looking north. That's an aerial shot of Tavernier in 1956. The National Geodetic Society photographed all the keys. We have all the photos from County Line to Long Key that I've been scanning. And by the way, I've been scanning and archiving all our photos. I've scanned close to 10,000 photos and photoshopped them. So that's the way I come up with the idea of doing these slideshows. I want to make some use of all having all these photos. And I wanted to share them with everybody, so that's why I've been doing these slideshows. This isn't exactly historical. In a way it is. It didn't open until, I think, the 60s. Up until, that was the first National Bank of the Upper Keys, which was sitting in Bayview. That was our first bank. Up until then, if you had a bank you could do, you had to drive all the way to Homestead. This was our first bank. And it was such a big event. when they had a dedication, the Cultural Band came and played music. It was a very big event, the opening of this band. And this is the old man coming into this church. It was on Tavern Street behind what is Froggy's gym now. Well, the Masonic Lodge is on this property now. So when they, they built a new tech, the Burton Memorial Church, Methodist Church was a tech. When they built a new church, that's when this originally was used in the Masonic Lodge, but they wanted to build a new, nicer lodge. So then John and Lois Storm came on. They wanted to save the church. So they were instrumental in having the church moved over to its present location, which in the near future will be the new Cafe Mocha. But the building was originally meant to be a community center. It was used that way for a while, but that didn't work out. And other businesses had moved there. There was a real estate office for a while. It was the home of the Free Press for a long time. And now, in not too near future, it will be the new Cafe Mocha. Back up. And that just shows the moving the church. They took the top off. And that shows them put the top back on. I always refer to it, they put the hat back on. And also, this is a Merlin Albury home. It was right close to where the old post office was, and it was moved, and it's just right next to the old church building. And that's where it's located now. And that's an early picture. That was when it was still a community center. It's too bad it's not still there to be used as a community center. Now we're back to the building that was Cafe Mocha. There's been a lot of different businesses in there. Even the old Tavernier restaurant started in that building before they built the building they have now. And another restaurant was in there, was the Papa Kettle. That was a very popular restaurant during the years it was open. Okay, this is notable people at Tavernier. Okay, he probably had more to do with creating Tavernier than anybody. That was H.S. McKenzie. And also another early Tavernier was Captain Rodney Albury. And he, I told a little bit of his history. He had a charter boat and fished many people like President Roosevelt. And he was just one of the early pioneers. But he was always there, like he was always greeted everybody at the door of the church. And voting day, he was always there to greet everybody. He was very active in the community. And that's an early photo of Harry Harris.
Harry himself.
This is when he had the first Harry Harris restaurant. That was a postcard. You know, it says Harry himself on it. And there's another person that's very active and doing a lot of construction in early Tavernier, and that was Doc Lowe. And I mentioned him earlier, he built the Key Haven. He was very instrumental in a lot of the early buildings of Tavernier, like Herb Alley. Back then it was a Jewfish, but now, as we know, it's Goliath Grouper. And another person you probably all have heard of, Kate Wilkinson. She wrote the book that we have to sail back there. It had to be you. In the 1930s, her and her husband lived in a tent out in what was a planter. And he was dragged from World War II, went off in World War II, and after World War II, they built a home on Tavernier Trail in Tavernier, which that home is still there. And this is a gallery on homes. Back, I guess, 5 or 6 years ago, some of the board members, Jerry and his wife Mary Lou, me, Charles Lewis, Everett Albury, and Charlie's daughter Anne, we did a walkabout and went around Tavernier identifying all the feel home to Tavernier, and that's what this gallery is going to be about. And now that's the old Berry Hall, that's what it looks like today. It doesn't look much like it, the original one. And that's at the end of Albury Lane. And that's another Albury house. And this other property is now the Driftwood Trailer Park. That's a little bit further to the north. Now we're on Tavernier Drive. That's behind the hotel. As I mentioned, there were quite a few historic homes on that street. This is known as McKinsey Hall. And next to that was McKinsey's father had a home. This is Charles Prof. Albury. He was a school teacher, and he was the first principal of Carl Shores. And back then, everybody just knew him as Prof. And this is on the corner of Tavern Drive and the south end of the Atlantic Circuit. This is the home of O.M. Woods. And one of the present, Maxine back there lives in that house. That's pointing her out. And that's the home of Perry Harris, our county commissioner for many years. And this is known as the Allen House. And the Stone Allen lives in this house. It was originally built by Herb Allen. As I mentioned, he was one of the early, did a lot of the early construction of Tavernier. And that's the Wilkinson House. It's on Tavernier Trail. This is a Ralph London house. It was on the ocean, and it was also on the Atlantic Circle. And this is, as I mentioned earlier, that's Stephen Shorty Carpenter's home, and it's on Sunrise. And that's the corner right there where there used to be the pull-up building there. It's torn down. It's a future home with some offices for the hospital. That's Sunrise, and that's where that home is located. And next to it was Mrs. Brennan's home, which was Shorty's mother's home. But over the years, a lot of different people lived there. I understand even Sylvia Murphy lived in the house for a while before she has her home she has now. And that's Charles and Florence Albury's home. That's on the corner. And this is one of the two Red Cross houses that were built in Tavernier. It was seven on Plantation Key and the rest in Alabama. 28 altogether. These were built after the 35 hurricane. The Red Cross came and built homes. If whoever owned a piece of property could apply and have one of these homes built on their property. A lot of you are probably more familiar with the ones in Alamorada because, like I said, most of them are in Alamorada. This isn't another thing. This isn't exactly historical, but it's very important to Tavernier was the building of the hospital, so this is the breaking ground for the hospital. And that was the early construction of the hospital. And now this is the last slide. I'm moving a little further south to show you what Tavernier Creek looked like in the mid-1950s. Wasn't much there. On the north side of the bridge there was Ray's fish camp, Ray Maloney. And if you notice on the right, in the middle there, the airstrip was there then. If you notice, you can see the airstrip and there's a plane sitting there. So that airstrip's been there a long time. And that's the end of the story.
Was that great or what?
Yes.